Thank you all for being here and for staying for our third presentation. My name is Sarah, and I'm here with my 10 teammates to present a qualitative study on the effects and impacts of a sustainable communities initiative on planning culture and equity in the Twin Cities, Bay Area, and Puget Sound regions. Here with me to present this evening are James, Juan Sebastian, Sam, and Amy. And the rest of our team includes Janice, Joni, Dov, Colleen, Joe, and Christine, who are throughout the audience. So tonight we're going to discuss our exploratory qualitative research design and some background on our case study sites. We will then dive into a discussion of the three main themes that emerged from this work, including regional approaches to equity, stakeholder engagement, and jurisdictional dynamics. We will conclude with a review of our understanding of how the Sustainable Communities Initiative has had lasting impact and been institutionalized into planning work in these three regions. So when the Sustainable Communities Initiative ended in 2013 and 2014, most grantee sites generated their own evaluation reports. Rather than duplicating those efforts, our objectives for this research were to see what had changed in the 3 years' time since the conclusion of those grants, and understand how the work initiated in the Sustainable Communities grants has matured or disintegrated. We also sought to leverage a triangulated approach with an exploratory, qualitative emphasis to tell stories other evaluations might have missed. And finally, we sought to provide a comparative study that might help to highlight new lessons and best practices for future programs like this, either within HUD or other federal agencies. These research objectives were really validated for us, particularly in our Twin Cities site visits. We spoke to previous evaluators who were really excited and curious to learn about what had lasted and what had changed, and emphasized how valuable this work would be to their work. Our objectives were also validated when we spoke to interviewees who talked about how earlier evaluations of their work in the Sustainable Communities Initiative hadn't fully captured the stories and richness of their experience. So, the research questions that have informed our analysis this semester are: what catalytic effects and lasting impacts did HUD's Sustainable Communities Initiative regional planning grants have in terms of 1, breaking down silos across sectors, issue areas, planning verticals, and jurisdictions, and strengthening regional relationships? 2, what effects and impacts did these grants have in terms of promoting a greater regional attention to equity? And 3, what effects and impacts did these grants have in terms of supporting and institutionalizing more equitable planning processes? We began this journey in January of this year, diving into the literature on regional planning, equity issues in planning, and existing evaluations of the Sustainable Communities Initiative, particularly in the Bay Area. We developed research questions that reflected what we had learned and what we wanted to learn more about in the Bay Area Sustainable Communities Initiative process. We decided a qualitative interview methodology would be most relevant and useful in answering our research questions, and through an iterative process with our entire class, developed an interview guide that reflected our research priorities. We spent the majority of February interviewing stakeholders and participants in the Bay Area. During this time, we also developed an interview codebook and analyzed interview transcripts, pulling out the key themes that emerged across our interviews. We then debriefed as a class, and in early March, identified the two case study sites that we wanted to compare our findings with. We settled on the Twin Cities and Puget Sound region. We chose these case study sites primarily because they look pretty similar to the Bay Area in many ways. Their similarities include that they all have strong market economies, they all have multiple urban jurisdictions within their regions, and they all have a high number and capacity of community organizations on the ground. We were curious to see if these similarities to the Bay Area led to similar outcomes in the grant process. And with this in mind, and based on what we had already learned in the Bay Area, we refined our research questions and began to develop our interview guides for the two new sites. We then got to work connecting with folks in both of the new regions, and members of our group traveled to each region to interview stakeholders and key informants. In April, we all reconvened in Berkeley to analyze our interview transcripts, produce a final report, and prepare for this presentation. So, like I said, from February to April of 2016, we conducted 54 interviews across our three case study sites. We sent teams to the Twin Cities, which includes the Minneapolis-St. Paul cities, and the Puget Sound region, which includes Seattle and surroundings, first in March and then again in early April, with the second site visits really building on and digging into the learnings that we brought away from our first site visits. Our interviews included both enthusiastic supporters of the Sustainable Communities Initiative work and also those individuals who may have been more critical of that work. To give you a better sense of the interviews that of the individuals that we interviewed, we spoke to a number of different folks in different sectors. We spoke to folks in regional public sector agencies, and these were primarily metropolitan planning organizations. We also spoke to folks in the local public sector, and that included city and county agency representatives. We spoke to individuals at small nonprofits and community-based organizations, as well as folks in larger nonprofits and in local and national foundations. And we also spoke to individuals representing the business sector. So before we dive into some more context about our three case study sites and what we learned in these interviews, I want to spend a moment sharing a bit more about our methodology. As I mentioned before, we've developed an interview guide for the Bay Area. We designed the guide to be broad and really flexible so that we could allow the richness and the nuance of the experiences within the Sustainable Communities Initiative in these sites to come through. We also wanted to let interviewees actually be participants in identifying the most important themes for us to explore. As we moved into the comparative case study selection, we refined and evolved this interview guide, allowing for different questions and areas of emphasis to emerge across sites, while still maintaining some basis for comparison over the next set of interviews. And similarly, we developed a process for coding the interviews that reflected our emergent learnings, but also allowed us to pull out some common themes and divergent outcomes. I think it's probably worth mentioning here that the data collection and analysis was a huge portion of the time that went into this semester's work, and we came away with over 60 hours of interview data and transcripts to work from. So what we're sharing this evening is a taste of the rich findings that we brought away from that work, and we think represents some of the key themes that begin to answer our initial research questions. And as a way of setting the stage for those findings, I'm now going to provide a bit of background on each of our case study sites. Please feel free to reference the handouts in front of you as I review these. As I mentioned, the first case study site that we looked at was the Bay Area, and their Sustainable Communities Initiative grant was called the Regional Prosperity Plan. It was a $5 billion grant that was awarded and implemented between 2012 and 2014. It was primarily steered by the Metropolitan Transportation Commission and the Association of City and Governments, which are the region's two regional planning agencies. The grant went primarily to funding pilot projects in affordable housing, in transit, and in economic development. In the Twin Cities, the grant name was the Corridors of Opportunity, and it was also steered by the region's regional metropolitan planning organization. They're called the Met Council. And it was also a $5 million grant, and it was implemented between 2011 and 2013. But it's important to note that unlike the Bay Area and the Puget Sound, this grant was supplemented by $19.1 million additional dollars in grants and loans from philanthropy, which also went to extending the administration of the grant for an additional year into 2014. The primary focus of the Corridors of Opportunity in the Twin Cities was the build-out of a regional light rail line, and along with transportation planning, these grants also had adjacent housing and economic development components. And finally, the SCI grant name in the Puget Sound region was Growing Transit Communities. This region, which includes Seattle and surroundings, as I mentioned, also received $5 million from HUD. The process was also steered by the regional metropolitan organization called the Puget Sound Regional Council. And like in the Twin Cities, it focused on the build-out of a regional light rail line with housing and economic development subcomponents as well. So, with that background in mind, I'm going to hand it over to James, who is going to begin our discussion of our key themes by sharing some insights on the three regions' regional approaches to equity.
So here you can see how HUD defines social equity values in the 2010 Notice of Funding Availability for the SCI Regional Planning Grant Program. As Sarah noted, we were very interested in seeing how SCI participants were impacted when it came to addressing and understanding equity at a regional level, and our interviews explored this in great detail. So we wanted to know how equity came up in the creation of each consortium, and given that these were all NPO-led projects, the role of NPOs came up frequently in conversation. A theme that emerged in interviews in all three regions was the belief that NPOs and social equity have historically not really gone hand in hand. And that in some regions, this lack of prior engagement with equity was evident in how they approached the SCI process. This came up the most likely, or probably in Bay Area, where some questioned the Metropolitan Transportation Commission's role as the lead agency and the consortium was serious about addressing equity concerns. As the quote here shows, one interviewee believed the MTO never truly intended to produce a shift in how it would engage with equity issues, hinting at underlying distrust among some of the more advocacy-oriented participants. In Puget Sound, similar doubts were expressed about the regional council's ability to lead an equity-based planning effort. And while participants we spoke with were closer to the inner ring of the consortium structure, felt the regional council's effort was sincere and not merely checking boxes, others were quick to point out that the MPO had traditionally been pretty removed from equity advocacy. As the quote to the right here suggests, some felt that the MPO's tight control of the process set it up for a status quo approach that didn't properly center equity issues. Finally, in the Twin Cities, there was a sense that equity issues weren't really on the Met Council's radar until 2010. It was that year that a grassroots campaign and a lawsuit aimed at bringing new light rail stops into St. Paul's historically underserved and predominantly African-American Rondo neighborhood resulted in a major change in the Federal Transit Administration's funding match policy. Soon after, Susan Haig would be appointed the Met Council Chair, who interviewees identified as a major force in steering the MPO towards a social equity focus into their SCI work. So while these tensions sort of foreshadow some of the challenges of collaborating on equity goals at this scale, the regional scale, it also points to an opportunity to find common ground. So when it came time to forming their consortium, our three case study regions each created equity-focused subcommittees, building space for equity into the process with varying levels of success. The stories of when and why these subcommittees emerged shines light on the strengths and shortcomings of each region's approach. In the Bay Area, despite the early inclusion of community-based organizations in the application process, an equity collaborative wasn't created until well after the original formation of the consortium, because certain participants felt that equity was not adequately covered by the other two working groups. This would allow community-based groups to legitimately impact the planning process and fund decisions, something that several interviewees indicated had been lacking historically. Building up an equity-centered space, as this participant attests, was a significant accomplishment. However, as the second quote indicates here, the subcommittee seemed to lack a clarity of purpose, which led some to feel like an isolated atom. As one interviewee put it, the equity collaborative got pigeonholed, limiting its impact on the broader effort. In Puget Sound, community-based advocacy and service-providing organizations were brought into the process early on. What one participant right here quoted on the left referred to as revolutionary stuff. Not only do these organizations help shape the grant's focus, but many of them would eventually form the Regional Equity Network, a subcommittee created to connect the regional planning community with sub-regional actors and ensure broad participation in the planning process. In addition to leading outreach to smaller organizations through a sub-grant program, the network was tasked with defining the equity agenda. The Twin Cities provides an interesting counterpoint or contrast. There, community advocacy groups weren't brought in until the tail end of the application process, and the group that was formed from these organizations wasn't focused explicitly on equity. Yet, while the community engagement team didn't feature equity in its name, its purpose, as one participant noted on the right here, was to, quote, create a powerful voice for low-income communities of color to secure community benefits. And similar to the Equity Network, the community engagement team provided sub-grants to smaller organizations in order to support their participation. In both of these regions, having subcommittees focused on community engagement might have broadened the scope of equity concerns and reduced the siloing effect mentioned in the Bay Area. It's also worth noting that in the latter two regions, which have much wider regional populations, minority representation on the consortium emerged as an explicit issue to be addressed. In the Twin Cities, there was actually a point where St. Paul's mayor stepped down and was replaced by his African-American deputy. That's something that some felt that had real symbolic significance, though in both regions there was a question of whether or not a small handful of people of color staffed at high-level committees represented a true shift in planning culture or mere tokenism. We also found interesting differences in how equity was discussed and understood in each region. In the Twin Cities, the conversation was expansive, highlighting the variety of ways racial disparities show up in metrics of social well-being, ranging from educational achievement to housing access. Several interviewees mentioned a collective realization that despite signs of prosperity at the aggregate level, the region had serious issues in terms of how this progress was being felt by different communities. As this interviewee put it, not everyone was benefiting from that growth. They took a shared prosperity lens and sought ways to close these gaps, with an explicit focus on the racial dimension of regional inequities. The Puget Sound region used a variety of technical tools to highlight disparate access to opportunities and life outcomes, which seems to have helped advance the policy conversation around equity issues by making inequity a measurable phenomenon, as one interviewee put it. In addition to expanding community participation, the Equity Network was actually tasked with producing a working definition of equitable development that could be shared with other SCI participants, as well as other regional actors as a guideline. These principles emphasized preventing displacement, something that Puget Sound had in common with the Bay Area. And while race was certainly a lens in the Puget Sound region, the emphasis was much less explicit, which members of the Regional Equity Network expressed regret over. The network, it should be noted, has continued on, albeit in a less formal and funded capacity, with hopes of tackling race more directly. Finally, a lack of focus on race-based inequities was also noted in several conversations with Bay Area interviewees. Or as one interviewee put it, quote, there was very little strategy-wise that was responsive to the nuances around race and ethnicity. Consistent with the regional prosperity plan's focus on housing affordability and expanding economic opportunity, interviewees typically discuss equity in terms of preventing residential displacement and improving conditions for low-wage workers. And finally, a quick note on the reach of these equity conversations. Generating a broadly supported understanding of equity was a key achievement of Puget Sound's equity network, as the quote on the left indicates. As several interviewees put it, equity and racial justice have become household names or buzzwords. In contrast, a shared definition of equity does not appear to have emerged in the Bay Area, perhaps due to a more charged political environment and more polarized views on the root cause of inequity. Twin Cities participants didn't feel that a regional understanding of equity had emerged in the process, but were pleased at the progress that was made in terms of putting equity on the map. As this city official put it on the right, there's clear optimism. The quote on the right says, the region has struggled to convert on a definition. And while the point of consensus hasn't quite arrived yet, there's a clear optimism that a consideration for equity now animates the planning and policy discourse. So now Juan Sebastian is going to tell you more about some of the dynamics we observed.
So the second topic we focused on in our research was stakeholder engagement. And like equity, stakeholder engagement was also at the heart of the SCI regional planning program. And as you've already heard, a major tenet of the HUD grant is to invest in the creation of these non-traditional partnerships to collaborate on regional planning. So to explore these dynamics across our case studies, we focused on how the regional consortia fared in engaging two typically removed sectors, businesses and historically marginalized communities. And what we found at a high level was that the SCI grant process largely magnified existing regional dynamics and tensions. Where distrust and animosity already existed, the collaborative struggled to meaningfully collaborate across silos. Where a culture of collaboration permeated, the regions were able to build on this strength and use the grant process to pull in stakeholders more deeply. This was particularly the case in business engagement. The first thing we learned here was that the success of these efforts varied depending on which businesses you were talking about. Our interviews differentiated between larger corporations, smaller neighborhood groups, businesses, real estate developers, and regional or statewide associations. Across all regions, major employers themselves, like Target in Minneapolis, St. Paul, Microsoft in Seattle, or Google in the Bay Area, were largely absent. Yet business interests were still involved at the table. Across our cases, regional business interests, such as the Chambers of Commerce or other regional associations, were engaged with varying levels of success, which I'll talk more about in a little bit. And in Minneapolis, St. Paul, and in Seattle, small businesses also played a slightly more active role in the local consortia, likely because of the direct impact that light rail construction had on their overall vitality. Now, tying back to our main finding in this subtheme, despite these commonalities, we found that each region's success at engaging business interests in regional planning efforts was contingent on the existing dynamics between businesses and planning. In particular, the extent to which businesses saw themselves as part of the community seemed to play a big role. Sorry, my notes got a little mixed up. So to illustrate this point, I'm going to tell a story from the Twin Cities. As you can see in this quote, large employers in Minneapolis-St. Paul had a pattern of involvement in regional planning efforts. As one elected official attested, we have a lot of Fortune 500 companies, a lot of corporate headquarters. We historically have been very philanthropically minded. Our local business community tends to support transit, which is great. What this elected official is referring to is a group called the Itasca Project. The Itasca Project is a behind-the-scenes employer-led alliance that seeks to address regional economic issues in the Twin Cities. And in this example, Itasca members helped lobby the state legislature for additional funding for mass transit investment after a former governor vetoed a transportation spending bill. In this sense, the Twin Cities was fortunate in that the regional businesses were already involved in regional planning efforts. This allowed the Quarters of Opportunity effort to really capitalize on those relationships in their SCI effort. However, these dynamics played out differently in each region. As I've already touched on, business engagement in Minneapolis-St. Paul was mostly conducted through partnerships with regional associations. Yet in terms of small businesses, we heard conflicting perspectives about how well they were brought into the process. While some interviewees felt there was a strong representative voice for small businesses at the table, several others noted that small businesses along the light rail corridor were not only hard to engage, but even unlikely to be even aware of the regional planning effort. The experience in the Twin Cities stands in contrast to that of the Bay Area, where regional business interests were involved at the early stages of the grant, yet ultimately departed from the partnership. The story of how one particular regional business group departed the partnership was often, though not universally, described as a major blow to the SCI grant. In the Bay Area's Regional Prosperity Plan, one of the subcommittees developed a regional economic development strategy. As the economic development framework evolved over the course of the grant to include issues of economic security, such as improving wages and benefits for low-wage workers, the Bay Area Council had growing concerns centered on union and labor agreement considerations that were included in the strategy. Ultimately, despite being one of the original grant partners, the Bay Area Council formally withdrew from the consortium and ended up producing its own alternative economic development plan, which it also submitted to the Metropolitan Transportation Commission for review. In Seattle, business engagement was mostly seen through the engagement of developers and small businesses. The Urban Land Institute, a representative of developer interests, was actually a key catalyst to the grant overall, as they originally approached the Puget Sound Regional Council with the idea of applying to the grant in the first place. Small businesses, on the other hand, were mostly engaged through the regional equity network's community engagement efforts as a part of the small business retention efforts along the light rail corridors. One interviewee claimed that these efforts set roots in the formation of a regional ethnic business coalition nonprofit, suggesting that there was some potential longer-lasting impact of small business engagement at the regional level. And despite this potential success among smaller businesses, larger corporations like Microsoft only acted in a distant advisory role. This quote from a regional agency employee captures this. Big employers were only willing to engage at a certain level. They were willing to come to a meeting and react to something and then go away. So as you've heard, the relative successes in business engagement across our regions were mixed. I'll now turn to another facet of stakeholder engagement, that of communities themselves, and discuss how our case study regions fared. And so with respect to community engagement, we found that a focus on building institutional mechanisms for deeper engagement led to greater lasting success. These mechanisms helped overcome some of the common challenges that we saw across all three cases. The first of those common challenges was that each region had to overcome a historic distrust of regional planning interventions. This was particularly true in the Twin Cities, where the historically black Rondo community had a legacy of being torn up by planning investments, such as the I-94 highway you can see in the picture on the right. This was a common sentiment raised across our interviews, And as you can see in this quote, a nonprofit director described that the region had to overcome that distrust now to get over this deep-seated suspicion. Another challenge our interviewees raised was the inaccessibility of technical planning jargon and mystified planning processes. To varying extents, all regions attempted to overcome this challenge with specialized trainings. The Puget Sound Regional Council, for example, held Planning 101 workshops in an attempt to shore up this lack of familiarity. And finally, both smaller community-based groups and residents themselves were challenged by having limited resources to participate in planning dialogues and meetings. In terms of common successes, the first we found directly relates to the challenge of resources that I just mentioned. Across all three regions, a main goal was to actually resource the engagement and participation of community groups. To varying extents, all regions felt that they had succeeded in this and were able to actually get resources or direct resources to new groups and new voices. A second common benefit of our case studies, community engagement strategies, was that smaller community groups gained greater exposure to and a greater understanding of planning processes and power dynamics. As one elected official shared with us in this quote on the screen, the overall grants really helped me to understand power a little bit better and how much within planning culture altering the power relations needs to happen. Further attesting to this benefit, another community leader in the Bay Area shared that they altered their own political organizing strategy based on the lessons that they learned from the collaborative process. Despite these commonalities, each region differed in the success of its community engagement efforts, with those that intentionally created institutional mechanisms for engagement seeing more success. And I'll describe those each in a little bit more detail. In the Bay Area, our interviewees saw mixed short-term success. We consistently heard that one of the many goals of the grant was to direct resources to smaller community-based organizations. Yet our interviews revealed little or unclear lasting engagement. While several of our interviewees did attest to the regional prosperity plan's success in funding smaller groups to do innovative projects, they also felt that these efforts did not add up to a comprehensive or targeted community engagement strategy. In fact, some of the grant-making decisions in the Bay Area were seen with some skepticism. Our interviews also revealed a perception that it may have just been a funding stream for organizations at the table already, suggesting that tensions that existed between smaller and larger advocacy and community groups had remained. In the Puget Sound region, the institutional mechanism for community engagement took form in the area's regional equity network, which James has already touched upon. In this case, the collaborative had a very targeted approach to community engagement, with the equity network almost exclusively focused on engaging communities of color and immigrant communities. As one community leader in the Puget Sound region shared in this quote on the left, if you want a real community engagement, the community itself has to be resourced. You cannot have equitable planning if the stakeholders are not resourced to participate in. In this case, stakeholders broadly felt that the regional equity network played a successful and crucial role in organizing community engagement. In the Twin Cities, the community engagement story is one of overarching success with a robust infrastructure and intentional power sharing, leading to lasting impact. As you can begin to see maybe by this chart on the right, the Twin Cities Corridor of Opportunity built a robust infrastructure specifically designed to give decision-making power to community members themselves. In their effort, the collaborative formed a community engagement team comprised of three grass-tops intermediary nonprofits that had previously not worked together. And this community engagement team was explicitly tasked with forming a new community engagement model for the region. As this quote from elected official highlights, the community engagement team's goal was to give people money and to let them make the decisions. The community engagement team did this by negotiating complete decision-making power over a smaller grant-making budget from the Metropolitan Planning Organization. It then handed over that power to a separate community engagement steering committee comprised of hyper-local community-based organizations. This intentionality around sharing decision-making power was repeatedly described as a successful attempt to disrupt existing power dynamics, and our recent interviews suggest that this has led to an increased capacity among community-based groups today. So aside from engaging businesses and communities, a big portion of the grant also dealt with cross-jurisdictional engagement, and I'm going to pass it over to Sam.
So not only did the SCI Regional Grant Program engage partners across sectors and issue areas, it also brought together stakeholders from across jurisdictions to collaborate on planning, equity, and development issues. And I'm going to talk to you about some of the stories, opportunities, and challenges that were shared with us about the ways in which the grantee regions were able to collaborate and promote policy reform across their diverse and varied jurisdictions. Our first big takeaway from this theme of jurisdictional dynamics was around participation. Although the SCI grant had an explicit focus on regional collaboration, not all of the case studies saw participation from all jurisdictions in an equal way. One thing that we heard across regions is that the grant provided the space and opportunity to have some really difficult conversations. In one of our interviews in the Bay Area, we spoke to an elected official who told us that some of the conversations that occurred within the steering committee became quite heated. But for the most part, he felt as if these conversations remained respectful and healthy. Similarly, we heard from a participant from Snohomish County in the Puget Sound region that there were some uncomfortable and tense conversations between advocacy groups and the Puget Sound Regional Council. But this interviewee also felt that those hard conversations led to fruitful outcomes. In the Twin Cities, several of our interviewees spoke to us about the contentious history that existed between St. Paul and Minneapolis. One of our interviewees who worked for a foundation explained to us that St. Paul has been thought of in the past and in some ways is still thought of as the underdog when compared to Minneapolis. She explained to us that St. Paul is the smaller of the two cities, the poorer of the two cities. It has less corporations and a smaller amount of philanthropy that's invested. I think it's important and interesting to note that in the Twin Cities, people really saw the grant as successful in bringing together St. Paul and Minneapolis and their respective counties, Ramsey County and Hennepin County. But the region really struggled to find ways of engaging and working closely with their more suburban jurisdictions. In the Twin Cities, the collaborative process began with only one suburban mayor involved in the entire grant, and we heard from an interviewee that the policy board realized that this was a major problem and attempted to bring on board a second mayor or an additional mayor during the second year. And despite this attempt, as the quote on the screen shows, representatives from these more suburban areas never seemed to be completely comfortable participating in the process. And while the Twin Cities struggled with this, the Bay Area and the Puget Sound region seemed to have better success engaging with both their core cities and their suburban jurisdictions. In both of these other regions, interviewees spoke to us about the value they saw in being able to connect grantees from different parts of the region to one another. Specifically in terms of capacity building and sharing of knowledge, they thought that connecting the suburban areas with fewer resources and advocacy groups with areas that had more resources was an important part of the grant process. Our second big takeaway from this theme of jurisdictional dynamics was around priorities and the fact that the planning priorities in core cities were different from the planning priorities in suburban jurisdictions. One major challenge that arose from cross-jurisdictional collaboration was identifying and pursuing strategies that would apply to the priorities of both the core cities and their suburban jurisdictions. And I guess it shouldn't come as a surprise, but what we heard from our interviews was that the conversations that were taking place around issues such as transportation, economic development, job growth, and affordable housing were really different depending on where you physically were in the region. And even when common goals were determined, the strategies and the tools that were found to be most effective in urban areas were often not the same as what was needed in the outer rings. And I'll talk more about that through a few examples. So first, in regards to transportation. In the Bay Area, we heard that the core cities were concerned with expanding bus service and connecting last mile connections between transit hubs and job centers. But for instance, in Contra Costa County, one interviewee shared that they were thinking about transportation more in terms of ride sharing and mobile apps. So although the region as a whole was thinking about transportation options, the ways in which different parts of the region wanted to expand those options differed significantly. This was similar to the dynamic in the Puget Sound region, where transportation needs were also diverse, but the consortium decided to focus the majority of their efforts on light rail. This was controversial, especially in parts of the region that were not benefiting from the light rail and weren't even expecting to be connected to the light rail for several years. In the Twin Cities, we heard more about the ways in which the region was attempting to deal with economic development. And as the quote on the screen shows, the region understood that the types of economic development tools and programs that were needed to stimulate the economy in different areas of the region could not be the same. And in order to address that, one of the major outputs from the grant was the creation of a core cities competitiveness strategy, which focused on creating jobs and attracting businesses and investment to the Twin Cities' racially concentrated areas of poverty. The Regional Economic Development Agency hopes to build off of this work to create other submarket strategies for the region's suburban areas as well as more rural communities. Our third and last takeaway from this theme of jurisdictional dynamics was that locally elected officials need incentives to act in the regional interest. Not only did we hear that different localities within a region had different priorities, we also heard a lot about how local interests were often at odds with regional interests. In the Bay Area, one community-based organization leader expressed their opinion that it's actually not in the best interest for cities or towns to invest in equitable development. They explained that cities depend on their tax base and the fiscalization of land to run their budgets, and as a result, they're interested in attracting big businesses and wealthy homeowners. And at the end of the day, it's not in these cities' financial interests to build affordable housing. In both the Bay Area and the Puget Sound regions, the boards of the regional planning agencies are made up of locally elected officials, and as a result, there's a real for these locally accountable representatives to carry out regional planning goals while remaining amenable to their constituents. One interesting story we heard in the Twin Cities was of an elected official who was deeply involved in the corridors of opportunity work, although the light rail line was not touching his county at all. And he explained to us that he got a lot of pushback and anger from his residents, and he needed to work really hard to explain why he was using his time and energy to focus on the build-out of this particular light rail line. Overall, we heard a lot of frustration around the fact that locally elected officials are expected to act in the regional interest without sufficient legal or political pressure. And I'd like to conclude my section with this quote. Ultimately, we can talk regionally, but it all boils down to local politics, local considerations, and that can never be forgotten. We can have all these regional aspirations, but parochialism is rife in this region. Now I'm going to turn it over to Amy, who's going to talk about lasting impacts of the HUD SCI grants in our case study regions.
So, long tonight, I promise, I'm the last speaker. Before we conclude, we'd like to very explicitly consider the lasting impacts and institutionalization of the SCI processes and findings across our three regions. For each case study, we aim to capture both the effects on the Metropolitan Planning Organization and their activities, as well as the broader implications, especially as they relate to considering equity in planning. In the Bay Area, we heard mixed results. Some interviews pointed to things that may change in the next round of Plan Bay Area, the region's Metropolitan Transportation Plan and Sustainable Community Strategy, new funding for affordable homes near transit, and the Metropolitan Transportation Commission's recent Affordable Housing and Displacement Forum both show signs of a continued commitment to equity in the regional planning process. One nonprofit representative told us about recent meetings where some commissioners still didn't consider displacement to be a regional problem, though, only something that was affecting San Francisco and Oakland. So even after this SCI process, not all of the regional planning agency's leaders agree on the issues at hand. The dispersed nature of the SCI grant in the Bay Area also may not have lent the process here to as much institutionalization as we saw elsewhere. We heard from interviews at the city level that other than a final report, little was done to implement the projects that subgrantees carried out at a larger level, projects that were billed as pilot or demonstration projects to learn from and then carry out at a regional level. Multiple people noted that the SCI process did strengthen the relationship between community-based organizations and the regional government. And as this quote highlights, community-based organizations now have a stronger understanding of the regional planning processes and are better equipped to affect change in those agencies and push for a greater focus on equity in the future. In the Puget Sound region, there is now a new regional equitable development initiative on the table, slated to be a revolving loan fund for strategic land and building acquisition for purposes of creating equitable development within transit communities. But funding is not yet in place for this new program. And while some interviewees call the SCI work in the Puget Sound region spectacular, many also lamented that the work is now sitting on a shelf. Puget Sound Regional Council did not come up with any staff to continue the work after the SCI grant, indicating a lack of institutionalization and perhaps a lack of prioritization for this work. Sound Transit, which is the light rail and bus provider in the Puget Sound region, has a $50 billion tax request proposal on the November ballot for the region. Puget Sound Regional Council successfully lobbied to ensure language around equity and transit-oriented development appears in this massive proposal for the transit network's build-out. Additionally, community-based organizations are now pushing for cities and counties in the region to adopt the equity portions of the SCI work into the local comprehensive plans so that accountability to those goals will exist at the most local level in addition to the regional level. And in stark contrast to the Bay Area and the Puget Sound region, the Twin Cities made major organizational changes that our interviewees identified as coming directly out of the SCI process. We had the chance to talk to leadership at Metro Transit, the region's transit provider, which operates as a division of Met Council. One key example of this is Metro Transit's expanded engagement and outreach team. This team used to be a single person siloed away in this very large agency. But in the wake of the quarters of opportunity work, Metro Transit has added 4 additional team members from community organizing backgrounds to this team. One interviewee highlighted how this team is meant to challenge the institutional inertia of such a large agency, and this expanded team's authority and influence is meant to prevent the voice of community engagement from being drowned out and overwhelmed by the entrenched practices of Metro Transit's bureaucracy. Interviewees also highlighted that Met Council updated their public participation plan to reflect the best practices from the corridors of opportunity community engagement work. And now those engagement processes are being used not just for transit projects in the region, but for all of Met Council's work. In addition to those organizational changes, Metro Transit is also now aware that working with communities they serve is the best way to affect meaningful change. The expanded engagement and outreach team is also focused on building capacity in the communities that Metro Transit serves. The agency has come to realize that they can never do it all themselves and must develop partners outside of the agency and even outside of government to be truly successful at identifying and implementing the services that communities need and want the most. Additionally, in the Twin Cities, Greater MSP, which is the Minneapolis-St. Paul Regional Economic Development Partnership, has developed the Regional Indicators Dashboard. The dashboard is a set of shared metrics tracking the region's progress in economic, environmental, and social outcomes as a means of maintaining and improving the region's economic competitiveness. Many of these metrics are broken down by both race and ethnicity to demonstrate the disparities in outcomes between whites and people of color. Those interviewees who mentioned the dashboard to us highlighted that this breakdown is key to tracking progress and making improvements that will help attract and maintain top talent reflective of the nation's increasingly diverse population. So as we near the end, I promise, of our presentation, we wanted to revisit our research question. We are most interested in the effects and the impacts of the SCI grant in each of these regions as they had to do with silos, relationships, and particularly institutionalizing equity. we heard earlier from both James and Juan Sebastian the importance of making intentional space for conversations about equity in the regional planning process. And to make a difference in equity, regional planning organizations have to get into community engagement and have to actually share power with the communities that they intend to serve. It's also important to notice and to acknowledge that regional planning has a long history that has helped create the tensions that we see today. Any successful regional collaborative must intentionally address regional tensions to support collaborative efforts. And Sam just highlighted for us that the Bay Area and the Puget Sound regions had greater success engaging with their suburban jurisdictions, that all regions struggled with the tension between core city priorities and suburban priorities, and that regional leaders still lack appropriate incentives to act in the regional interest. And I'd like to note that while we had the chance to talk to many great people about their experiences as part of the SCI process, there are many more conversations that we just didn't get to have. Some additional stories we heard you can find in our full report, or we may get to during Q&A here in a minute. But with such a huge multi-year, multi-player investment, we want to acknowledge that there are many more narratives about these communities and their experience with the SCI grant that we just did not capture. The SCI grant closed after only two rounds of funding. During our first weeks of the course, we heard from folks at HUD that they wished for silo-busting, collaborative, and equity-focused work, much like the SCI grant, to become their business as usual. We hope that we've added more color to the existing evaluations of the Sustainable Communities Initiative program, and that this work may help inform similar federal grant programs for regional planning in the future. And at this time, we would be happy to take your questions. Five of us are happy to start out fielding the questions, but as Sarah mentioned before, there's actually, we're a team of 11, so our other 16 members are hanging out in the audience and will jump in accordingly. We'd be happy to take questions and hear feedback.
I'm curious, sort of your observations around the differences between the three places and the organizational structures. Just thinking about the variation between power between the Met Council and the Puget Sound Regional Council. Those are the two I'm most familiar with, but there's some pretty significant differences there.
Are you curious about what the difference is?
Yeah, you know, you came to different conclusions. How much of those conclusions are driven by what the organization's span of control is, where their power resides, etc.?
While you're thinking about that, can I just add on a little bit more? Just, it's interesting to me that there was no spatial explanation of the three regions in terms of their basic metropolitan structure. The size of central cities, the nature of fixed rail or light rail transits, the dispersion of communities, the balance between suburban and the total population, the Bay Area being 7, the other 2 being 4 million each. And it just seems to me that this question of what you start with, which I think is implied there, is a really interesting part of this. And I too would be interested to know what you thought, how you thought about it.
To take your question first, I think that those were really important variables that were factored in when we made the decision about selecting these two case study sites. We didn't want to go through that here in this presentation, so we could dive into the findings, but I think that weighing those various variables in terms of region size and what the similarities and differences were across sites was something that we went through as a broader team to think through and decide whether or not these were the right case study comparison sites or not, and we ultimately settled on them based on those variables.
But I'm talking about the difference between the three, which I think is the same question that she was asking. Explaining the three, not your choice.
I think that one of the things that Sam highlighted briefly that was particularly interesting, actually four of the five of us standing here all have the chance to go visit the Twin Cities, is that the Met Council is, as a regional government, is not made up of elected officials, and that is a huge difference compared to the other two regions that we looked at. So as Sam mentioned, here and in the Puget Sound, the folks that make up the metropolitan planning organizations are generally city council folks and county supervisors that then help or work for the broader government. But for the Met Council in the Twin Cities, all of the members of their board of directors are actually governor appointees. And that political process certainly, we believe, shaped
a lot of the discussions and certainly the timeline of how things played out in the Twin Cities. There was a new governor elected, a Democratic governor elected in 2010 in the Twin Cities, so immediately before they got this funding, and as James mentioned, as a result, the entire Met Council switched over and they got a new chair, Sue Hay, who really, really was active in pushing a more socially equity-driven agenda. And so having a whole new board of directors that don't have to deal with balancing local incentives quite the same way certainly plays into the outcomes.
I have a couple questions. This is one of the most important is, what's up with the Warriors?
I can tell that's
serious. That's a serious question.
Well, I'll answer that.
Thank you.
So, Janice is not here tonight, but when Janice and I were in the Twin Cities, it was a night when the Warriors were playing whoever the basketball team is. Sorry. But we were, and we were staying at the same hotel as them, and we got some pretty exciting sightings of the different, and pictures and videos that we could share with you at offline. So thanks to them, we really inspired.
You have to travel somewhere else.
Right? Yeah.
All right, so my serious question is, I'm really interested in the Twin Cities, and I'm interested in the 19.1 million extra bucks that they got. Mm-hmm. And that seems to me to be an important variable, in addition to the Met Council composition, which is really interesting. Mm-hmm. So I would like to hear a little bit more about this $19 million. Who provided, as much as the details, who provided, what was the timing of it? Was it directly related to this? Were they happening with the $5 million later? You know, a little bit on that, because it just seems like that has a significant role in there being enough money to staff all this stuff.
Yeah.
So that's my question.
So the $19.1 million came from Living Cities, which at the time had this five-city regional initiative, similarly supporting cross-sector collaborative work in five different cities. It was tied directly to the SCI grant, so they the Twin Cities joined the two of the both grant programs into one. And it did actually come up significantly in our interviews. I think some of the main takeaways that I had were that a lot of people felt that having that additional money to do that additional money was a bit more flexible to do more implementation and do short early wins while they were doing this larger, longer scale planning actually helped hold people at the table a little bit longer or help them see what some of the benefits would be in the long term. I think that's one of the big things that came up to me, and I think there was also a lot of capacity building that they said that they were able to benefit from that Living Cities Innovation Initiative dollars.
Did those dollars, whenever you get dollars, there's strings attached, right, and that motivates people to do more stuff. So is that kind of what you're saying was happening with this with the grant, the benchmark?
So,
they attach more equity lens to it, even more so than the SCI grant, because there's $19 million.
I wouldn't say that the equity lens came from the Living Cities grant. I think that so I forget the exact portion of it, but most of the $19.1 million were actually debt, so low interest rate debt, and then I think market rate debt, yeah, loans. And I forget the exact amount that was grants. But in terms of whether or not that actually had an impact on the equity focus that the Twin Cities seem to have, I don't believe we heard that much.
No, in fact, I think most folks on the ground had no idea what money was coming from HUD and what money was happening in Living Cities. It became pretty seamless, which we were actually pretty surprised to hear. But it was pretty seamless on the ground.
Hey, so all of this is with me, but the CSI grant seemed like a great program to mobilize and organize community members for equitable results. What struck me as interesting was, Amy, you said that they weren't able to have like an institutionalizing effect. So once they mobilized and organized these networks, were they not did they use some sort of internet network or some sort of platform to organize? Are these networks still active? Do these coalitions exist?
So I can say that in Seattle, we kind of touched on it, in the Puget Sound region, there is an effort to continue the regional equity network. And there is at least one person that's staffed and funded to continue to try to organize the people that participated in it. And they are trying to put more of an emphasis on racial equity and incorporate more communities of color. But because there's no funding, like everyone's doing it voluntarily at this point, so it's definitely an issue because these people are doing it on top of their day jobs. And so in order to like sustain that, I definitely feel like more funding needs to come in. And they're trying to do more through online, there's a website, but there's not a lot of evidence so far that it's been institutionalized, I guess is what you're getting. But there are efforts.
If what you said at the end happens with the bond measure and the resources, that script totally flips. And then there's also a lot of local action that is going, that you're starting to describe. So I noticed your interview pool is a little lower with the Seattle group. So I think even as you guys go further with this, they're like, I'd love to see who you got to talk to, who else you might want to talk to round that out. I do think there's some tremendous opportunities still in the Puget Sound area that's taking you in part because of
it. It does sound like PSRC has also incorporated some of those efforts. There's a TOD advisory committee that they have, and that's what, from what I've heard at least, that's the entity that's been putting some of the pressure on the legislature to incorporate that language into the bond proposal, the tax proposal. And there's definitely a lot more room to explore in that.
I was just going to say, in terms of the infrastructure and the methods through which these coalitions interact, I think to the extent that they were able to solidify that structure prior to engagement, it informed how successful they were in continuing that engagement ahead. So in Puget Sound, the Regional Equity Network was well established from the very beginning in terms of their structure and their role and who would be a part of that. And that's why they were so successful at what they did and why they've been able to continue in some iteration. Here in the Bay Area, there wasn't necessarily a similar structure, but there were relationships in place among the CBOs that participated, and I think many of those that we interviewed would argue that the process strengthened those relationships and allowed them to better understand the process for regional planning, such that they are now working on a new coalition that has been strengthened and expanded. It's not directly related to the SCI planning initiative, but it was in a sense a related outcome by which some of those CBO coalition members were able to kind of create deepened relationships and expand a new coalition effort in the Bay Area.
So one of the things that really stuck out to me, and when Sebastian said it, well, if you can't have equitable planning if the stakeholders are not resourced to participate. So I'm wondering, like, what do you all think about the idea of collaboration between like multinational corporations that have extensive resources and communities who have been historically marginalized? Like, how can that ever actually produce equitable outcomes?
When you get the answer to that,
I think that something we talked about a lot is that there are certain tensions and incompatibilities at the regional level, especially when you're talking about all these diverse types of actors that are just never going to be reconciled. The degree to which you can convince a company like Target to, you know, commit to local hiring and paying a living wage and incorporating input from diverse communities through something like this, I think it's maybe a little bit beyond the scope. But, you know.
Yeah, I mean, to put a finer point on it, I think that's where the public sector comes in, ideally. And I'm not sure that we could say for sure that we saw that, you know, them playing that intermediary role between communities and corporations in the way that we might want to see to ensure that power imbalance. But I think that's the point.
I think also in Puget Sound, a lot of people on sort of all sides of stakeholder groups commended the facilitator, who is sort of at the head of the process, for being successful in allowing voices to be heard and acted upon. So no matter how small your voice is in that sort of chain of stakeholder influence, I think a lot of people felt like there was meaningful engagement from some of the smallest CBOs. Again, the largest employers maybe weren't engaging, but those that had large voices in terms of power were at the same table as the CBOs, and I think a lot of people felt that they were all able to meaningfully engage because of the role the facilitator played in making sure that they were each a part of that process. I don't know that that translates to meaningful outcomes necessarily, but I think a lot of people had sort of positive takeaways in terms of the process.
That was a great presentation. I had a question about whether something came up in your interviews, because it occurs to me you're talking about regional planning in the context of federal funding, and so there's this layer of government in between those, right? And you've picked three sites that just happen to be in states that are historically, that have legislatures, that are historically dominated by the Democratic Party. You could very easily have picked metros like Atlanta or Detroit that wouldn't match that. So I'm wondering, did anyone that you were interviewing speak about the role that state government had to play in the conversation?
I don't know. I mean, certainly we did hear that come up in terms of the Met Council, because they're a state, they're a governor appointed body, and that shapes everything when you're essentially your board of directors is all coming from a state level, and it means that, not that all Democrats are the same, but at least everybody's that much on the same page going in, that you're all appointed by somebody from the same side of the aisle. I'm trying to think if we heard about kind of state influence in either the other regions, or at least as strongly.
I don't think it's
strongly. No. But, I mean, but there's something to be said about that this is continuing research, and we selected three regions, and you know, I don't remember at this point whether that was a conscious decision or not in terms of how we chose them, but the good is that we controlled for that.
Yeah.
The bad is that we don't know how it would be different elsewhere as a result, and that would be something really interesting for us to explore, you know, as Karen continues this work and maybe expands other pieces.
Well, the contrast would be you could have picked Portland, Maine, where about 3 months into the process, the governor tried basically eliminate the planning departments of the state, you know, or North Carolina, where they actually reversed an initiative that had been going for 5 years to do economic development through equity. You know, so yeah, you could have got a different story, but you wouldn't have had much to work with in terms of comparison. So I think if you were doing a broader analysis, that variable would be really interesting to explore a bit more. And frankly, just speaking from having been in that office, one of the things we felt we didn't get to do effectively as much as we wanted was the state engagement piece around how to, you know, move the needle in some of those places.
One of the findings that I thought was really interesting was how the grant either magnified the either positive nature of existing dynamics or sort of the tensions. So I'm wondering if you have any thoughts thinking about future iterations of this program. What could change? I mean, it seems like we want to continue doing the same thing with those places where it's magnifying positive things, but what could be changed so that it's not magnifying the negative dynamics in certain places?
Yeah, that's a great question. We were grappling with how with what to do after presenting that kind of finding. I think one of the places where we landed was that, like, it may sound like a pop-up, but that, like, it takes a lot of intentionality. And it's like unclear what it would look like at a regional scale to address those issues of animosity and distrust, and that really did come up a lot in our interviews here in the Bay Area. So that's not really, I guess, an answer, but I do think that being aware of it and actually being somewhat more intentional around acknowledging that or addressing it or working towards or something is at least a step.
And arguably $5 million just isn't enough.
There's no argument
that's not enough. I want to add something from Seattle. Something that was really interesting that we learned in Seattle is that TSRC, which is really in charge of the grant there, was very intentional and had a lot of control over the process from everywhere, from, you know, scripting the agendas to determining even what the grant was going to be about. And they talked about how early on in the process there was a lot of sort of animosity between, not animosity, but intense disagreement between regions that were more light rail served and regions that weren't rail served, and people were saying, you know, this should be about ferries, this should be about highways, this should be about light rail. And PSRC really stepped in with a tight grip on the situation and said, this is going to be about light rail. And I think to a certain extent, things went a lot smoother after that happened. And yes, people were excluded from the conversation after that and from the process. but to the extent that they addressed light rail and transit-oriented development around light rail, I think it was much more successful. So I think there is something to be said for a strong element of the grand administrator control.
Mm-hmm. Related to that, the federal government in the 60s started funding a lot of community engagement, citizen participation, and many of the other spinoffs, most of which was oriented around seizing power, and not unlike the power balance you described here today. But most of that always had to see the establishment of governance and policy direction through governance as the ultimate goal, because simply sustaining engagement is not going to happen over the long term. You can't keep funding participation and expect it to really do more than just be loosely effective. You need, just as the situation in Portland is showing, a situation with a relatively strong institution setting the direction, the ability to have a central appointment in the Met Council situation. So what did you hear or see about the role of evolving governance to build from this increased participation? And what do you think about it personally?
The community engagement team and kind of where they're going now in the Twin Cities. So a few of our team members talked about the community engagement team in the Twin Cities, and you can't tell, we came out of this kind of big fancy Twin Cities. they did really, you know, kind of in a more storytelling format, really interesting things. So the Met Council and the City of St. Paul and the City of Minneapolis and whoever else was at the table were writing this grant application to HUD, and as the folks who eventually were part of the community engagement team told us, they pretty much got the phone call at the 11th hour from that government structure saying, hey, we need to do more around community engagement to get this grant, so can we give you some funds and you'll go talk to the community and we'll go from there. And the what ultimately ended up being the community engagement team, which was three different major partners in the region, came back and said, sure, we'll do this, but we're not going to take any of the money. We're going to hand it off directly, pass through to other community-based organizations. And they took that even one step further. So rather than the community engagement team, these three very established organizations deciding, this organization gets money, this one doesn't, this one does, they then established another layer of governance underneath that, a truly community-based governance structure that decided where the ultimately, I think it was $750,000 in sub-grants went. But we got a chance to talk to the community engagement team, three folks from it, during our second trip to the Twin Cities, and they extended their process, I think twice beyond the life of the Sustainable Communities Initiative funding and found other outside funding, some of it the Living Cities funding, I believe, some of it other, to then continue doing those sub-grant projects. But they've now decided to sunset in about a month because they feel that so much capacity has been built at those community organizations that they were originally working with. These small, one, two, tiny, you know, $50,000 budget organizations have seen so much growth in capacity over this 4 or 5 year time period that now they don't need to exist and keep doing that. So I think that's a really interesting and successful example about sustained community engagement can build capacity that then can lead to more community engagement through other partners.
And to build on that, and I think Amy highlighted this in her lasting impact section, but one of the main things that the community engagement team was advocating for, the community engagement steering committee, which was the layer under them, was the creation of an equity advisory committee within the Met Council structure itself, which ended up starting at some point in the last year, I forget exactly when. But that was actually, I think they saw that as an extension of their work and a way to actually ingrain within like the decision-making structure of the region. And it was spoken of as a success or as a next step.
So I got distracted by the Warriors. I should have first complimented you. It was a really interesting presentation since I've been involved a little bit on this with Karen and Miriam. And the question that I had, the last question I had is about the success that you saw in two of the regions for the suburban community involvement. And so I was wondering if you could speak to that, and for the one that didn't have success, what would you recommend that you could do for a group that would be related to something?
Yeah, so that was It was a really interesting dynamic between the core cities and the more suburban jurisdictions. And one shortcoming in, I think, our research was that we weren't actually able to, at least in the Twin Cities, speak to anyone who was involved a little bit or just wasn't involved at all in the grant from the suburbs. And I think moving forward with this research, if more is done in the Twin Cities, I think we'd really like to connect with some of those people and to really understand, did they feel excluded? Did they feel uncomfortable, which was what we were hearing from the core cities, was that they felt uncomfortable, they felt threatened, and maybe that's true and maybe that's not. And so I think that we explained what we heard from one side. And so I think that there's still a part of the story that's missing. I don't know if you guys have anything to add in terms of what happened in the Bay Area or Seattle or what could have been different in terms of engaging those more suburban areas.
And just to speak to Seattle, I think in Seattle they made a real effort to include people from those outlying districts, and they even held some of their meetings in those areas.
Yeah.
There was significant drop-off from Seattle participants at those particular meetings, but they did make the effort. And they also, on the sort of CBO side in that region, they developed equity, sort of the regional equity network had kind of sub-programs that focused specifically on corridors in Tacoma. I think there's one other region, so some of those outlying counties that specifically touched on some of the small business communities on those like Redland corridors and other community groups in those areas. So by kind of breaking it down into those more focused work products, they were able to engage those areas a little bit more successfully. I'm not sure about.
I think here, you know, there's a lot of benefits in Seattle and the Twin Cities that they were so focused on the build out of light rail, but one of the really great benefits of the Bay Area not doing it that way is they had a lot more flexibility in terms of dispersing the money, and that helped disperse involvement as well. I mean, we all know it's a huge geographic region. I mean, you don't even think about some parts of the Bay Area as being part of the Bay Area, and so the ability to spread funds that far at least helped keep those people involved in the process in a way that I think is just a lot harder. Sam mentioned there were some folks who, even if the light rail project didn't touch them, stay involved, but that's a lot harder to sell than if you're a county supervisor and a community-based organization or a nonprofit or even your county, some county department received funds. There's actually, if you ever feel like going back and looking at it, ICF did an evaluation report of the Bay Area process before we came in, and they did some really nice maps overlaying the community concern and the priority development areas in the Bay Area and where grants were given out. And I think that speaks to you disperse the funding and you help bring people in and keep people at the table. And there were some requirements, I believe, tied to that funding to participate and report back, and that helped keep people involved.
And I'm going to add one quick note that's kind of interesting is how existing conditions, the types of things that they're actually trying to improve upon in terms of transit reach and things like that, actually directly impact the reach of involvement in some of the further flung parts of the region. So that's something that came up a lot, just logistics. Since a lot of the MPOs are based in the core, people that live 2-hour train rides outside are just not going to be compelled to make the trip in to sit in on a 1-hour meeting, maybe make a statement or two, and then go back. So it's kind of an interesting little like catch 22. It's exactly the type of things that they're trying to improve, I guess, their connectivity. So I don't know enough about the other regions in terms of the transit accessibility and things like that, but I think that's probably a big factor.
So just following off of that last statement, so is it the stakeholder engagement plan between these three regions which actually determine whether they're successful or not, something like that maybe? Would you guys be willing to comment on how the stakeholder engagement plans were devised?
By stakeholder engagement, you mean just generally how the consortia work?
The actual plan of how you're going to reach out to each community and get them and what's going on with this.
Yeah, I'm not sure we could establish causality between the nature of the community engagement plan and the success of the grant overall. But I think given the level of attention that it got, disproportionate, I would say, level of attention that it got in our interviews, disproportionate to the amount of funding that it received as part of the overall package, I think that speaks to the fact that there was a culture change, particularly in the Twin Cities, but I think in the Puget Sound as well.
I think we don't wrap up.
One last question.